Hi, I'm Mary Ellen, and welcome to this week's video presentation about a vintage historical marker. On 31 May, Southport Historical Society will begin the online auction. Join us every Wednesday for a new video presentation. Our vintage marker today is one that is important to me, as well as other locals, the Southport fishing industry. The Cape Fear riverfront from Kingsley Street to the Yacht Basin was the prominent location. The marker focuses more specifically on the Menhaden fishing. Menhaden fishing is one of America's oldest businesses. The fish, a member of the herring family, is not eaten by humans because of its bones. Menhaden were originally used for fertilizer, and in later years serves as a valuable ecological resource. I'm pleased to introduce Donald Sellers to tell his exciting firsthand knowledge of the industry. Donald is quite accomplished. He is the author of When Dreams Took Flight, telling of his dream of becoming a pilot. His varied career includes piloting Army helicopters in Vietnam, single-engine fish-spotting aircraft up and down the East Coast, and finally his 20-plus years of airline flying with Piedmont Aviation and U.S. Airways. Follow me and let's go to Kingsley Park, where you will enjoy Donald's presentation.
My name is Don Sellers, and I'd like to share with you my experiences as a little boy growing up at the Menhaden Fish Factory. My parents started work there in 1949 for their purpose. They were cooks. They served three meals a day to 40 to 60 men, and where my mom hand rolled 200 to 300 biscuits daily and cooked them in a big oven. This is where I got my first airplane ride at 5 years old with Hall Waters, who was the primary or the original spotter pilot for the company. He taught me to fly later on when I got big enough to reach the controls, and he soloed me in his airplane at 15 years. Our day would normally start out something about like this. At 5 o'clock in the mornings, we would get in the family Jeep and drive down to the factory, and Mother and Dad would start arrangements, cooking for breakfast. And I had my own chores also, which was setting the table and putting food on the table and just various little things I helped them with. Around 6:15, the men would come in for breakfast, and by 7 o'clock, breakfast was over and they would start to work. And by then I had finished my chores, and the next thing, I would go out on the porch and wait for Hall to fly in with his airplane. I'd look out over the ocean, over Yopon, and I'd pick him up, he'd be circling, and then he'd start my way. And I knew I was going flying. So I'd jump in the Jeep, he'd buzz the kitchen, I'd pick him up at the airport, and We'd come to the kitchen, he'd eat breakfast. I couldn't eat breakfast, I was too excited. But after that, we'd go back to the airport, and I'd jump in the back of his airplane, and I'd sit on magazines or big cushions or anything I could to see out over the side of the plane. I couldn't reach the rudder pedals, but I could hold the joystick, which is a control stick in the back seat. We'd either take off down the highway going to the south towards the factory, or we'd turn left and take off to the east on the grass strip. And every control movement input Hall made, I was right there with him. I knew every time that stick moved, I had my hand on it. And it didn't take long before I knew how to fly that airplane. We'd climb out over the ocean, and for 4 to 5 hours, we would be spotting fish, and he would help the boats direct them and catching them. And at time to refuel was generally around lunchtime or shortly after. excuse me, we would come back in. I'd let him off, and he would get in the airplane and go back to work or go to Wilmington where he lived at or whatever, and I would go back to the factory. And as a little boy, it was the biggest playground in the world. I would either go to the net fields and help Captain Church and two brothers, Georgie Clemens and Babe Clemens, mend nets, or I'd go to the carpenter shop and hang out with Mr. Joe Reeves, and I got to build with hammers and saws. I'd build everything, boats and cars, but mainly airplanes, and I'd fly them all over the factory. Or I might even go on the docks down there with my BB gun, shoot fiddler crabs. Lots of times I went into the machine shop and hung out with Mr. Stud McKiffin. And he'd always give me some kind of big tool to play with, or a nut or a bolt to tighten, or he always had some project for me. Lots of times I'd go to the electrical shop and hang out with Mr. Harry Sell. And he always had a little words of wisdom for me. But anyway, I had a playground that was unlike anything else. The things would be slow until the boats started coming in around 3 or 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoons, and at that point, it really got hectic. It was a very hard labor, manual labor, and it was in a most hazardous work environment. I knew of many men that were injured or killed throughout the years there. It was just a tough, hard place to work. It also was segregated, and that being said, up at the kitchen where my parents cooked at, it was divided in two rooms. One was for the blacks and one was for the whites. I never really understood what segregation meant, but because I ate with all of them, I hung out with all of them. They even had bunk houses where the men stayed. When they were working 24-hour shifts, they would have bunk houses for the blacks, and they had same thing for the white. And of all things, the bathroom on the dock was a small building, open building, but it had a partition in the middle, blacks on one side, whites on the other. It was just a way of life back then. This particular plant had a payroll that was the highest of any operation in Brunswick County up until Sunny Point Army Terminal and CPNL came in. It employed people from all walks of life all over Brunswick County, and Brunswick County is a very big county, as you know. It paid house payments, car payments. It put food on the table, supplies to kids going to school. Other than farming, it was the backbone of Brunswick County. It had one little small downfall, though, and that was the odor that was produced whenever the fish were being processed. To the locals that lived here, we didn't even notice it. Didn't pay any attention to it. It was called the smell of money. To an outsider, it was almost unbearable. In the summertime, when the winds were predominantly out southwest, it would float the smell over Southport like a cloud, particularly early mornings and late in the evening. And then in the fall of the year, when people were coming down to vacation on the beaches and fish, because this area was known for fishing, particularly in the fall of the year, the winds out of the north, it would blanket the beaches. You couldn't seem to get away from it. To us, it didn't matter, but to them, it was tough. Kind of had an incident that I remember so well. There's a salesman who worked for Singletary out of Wilmington, and in the kitchen one afternoon, he asked my dad, he said, Elmer, he said, how in the world can you and your wife work here in this kind of environment, something that smells this badly? And I never will forget what my dad told him. He said, Floyd, you know, it's certainly not the best job, and it sure isn't the worst job, but you know what, Floyd, it's my job.